Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner, available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, I'm going to give you the 2023 update to my C++ best practices ultimate CMake starter. Just wanted to take a quick moment to shout out to all of my patrons, people who have supported the channel over the years, people who have attended my classes and brought me out to their companies for training. Be sure to check out the video description here for links to all of those things, books that I have, and the like. Okay, so this is the 2023 update for my C++ CMake Ultimate Starter. So I've had these templates for quite some time now, and as you can see here, the one that ultimately ended up becoming the GUI starter template now has 2,390 stars on it. I have archived this project. I also have the boilerplate template, which now has 174 stars on it. I have archived that as well. These things had become a little bit too confusingly separated. And I've, you know, many different forks, open issues, pull requests on these things, but I was becoming dissatisfied with these projects. So I have simplified everything down into just one that I have called CMake Template. This no longer uses Conan. It has minimized external dependencies. It has been drastically cleaned up so that it is now fetch contentable, and huge amount of changes over the years in general that if I were logged in right now, I could just click use template and this thing will automatically be renamed into whatever project name I give it. So where is the ultimate part here? If you've watched any of these previous episodes about my CMake work and what I am aiming for towards ultimate, it's all about tooling. So I'm going to jump straight into the project options and we're going to get a quick look at this. So by default, you are going to have address sanitizer, undefined behavior sanitizer, fuzzing examples built, interprocedural optimization, IPO, also known as link time optimization, and I've recorded several episodes about why that is important and necessary, so make sure you watch those. Warnings as errors, which I know I'm going to get a ton of hate for, so that's one reason why I leave it as default. But note, if you are a packaging maintainer, then these things get disabled. So clang tidy enabled, CVP check enabled, and options for pre-compiled headers. So the main changes that I want to talk about, first of all, is that this thing is now actually fetch contentable, and that is for good reason. And that is partially because I have changed my dependency management to now use CPM. And CPM doesn't require any external tools to be added. It is simply this simple. And I've already done an episode on CPM as well. Let's go ahead and jump into this CMake folder and talk about hardening, because this is really the main difference from previous years. And this means by default, when you build this thing, you're going to get hardening options that happen to exist in your compiler. And these, I know some of them need a little bit of help here, but if you're on Visual Studio, SDL, and Control Flow Guard, these are things that prevent people from exploiting your binaries. If you're on GCC, then you're going to get built-in glibcxx assertions. What this means is if I try to do an index access into a vector, this is now a checked access, and it's not undefined behavior if I index past the end of the vector. Oh no, that's going to slow down my code. Whatever shall I do? Well, stop using indexed operations on your vectors. Use ranged for loops and algorithms. You're going to get enhanced fortify source. There are some good articles about fortify source from the Red Hat team. I'm playing with whether or not I force position independent executable. We'll see about that later. Stack protector gets, I think, is a pretty good idea. And this is to prevent people, again, if I am doing something that accesses past the end of the stack, then I'm going to get an error in my code instead of vulnerable code. I'm not sure about the utility of clash protection. You can look that up, but I also have control flow protection. I believe that is similar to Microsoft's control flow guard. And then this is a huge change. You are going to get by default the undefined behavior sanitizer, minimal runtime. Let's take just a minute to talk about this. Minimal runtime. There is a minimal UBSAN runtime available suitable for use in production environments. This is a version of the undefined behavior sanitizer designed for shipping your binary with. I'm at the moment configured this with default options in here, except that I do say that you're supposed to get a crash if anything from the undefined behavior sanitizer triggers, and that is this fno sanitize recover. Instead of simply printing a report and continuing execution, I say print the report and then exit the program. And if you're at all familiar with undefined behavior sanitizer, it's going to catch many of the same types of things that checked integer operations are going to check. So that's spectacular. If you get an overflow or something that it can catch for, notice this signed integer overflow, then I'm going to get an actual crash in my program. And great, that makes my code safer. And it attempts to detect if your compiler supports these things before enabling them, and then prints out a whole set of debug messages for what features it was able to enable. And it optionally has the option of pushing these down to your dependencies. So that is another reason why I'm using CPM here instead of other package managers. Laying this out like I have means that you can choose which hardening and LTO and sanitizers you want, and to some extent be able to pass those down directly to your dependencies so you can catch as many errors as possible across your project. And of course, this has been updated to use the latest version of all of these dependencies as well. And if you've used any previous versions of these template projects, you may have gotten frustrated with how hard or easy it is to set any of the options. So all of these are now just straightforward top level CMake options. And all of these things that currently say my project get automatically filled in by the template janitor when you actually create a version of this template. You just have to wait a minute. GitHub's going to automatically run a process for you that will rename it to be the name of your project that you just created. And another change that I made was at one point we had external all of these project options in a different project that we then pulled in with fetch content. But that made it very difficult in the case where you wanted to actually make harder tweaks to the kinds of default error messages, warnings that you were using, or flags to the various tools. So now it's all in here, and that was necessary for, well, two reasons. One, maintenance is made much easier this way, but also so that we could properly rename all of the functions that are being used instead of having potential naming conflicts between the functions. So I think that basically covers everything here. But we do have also some example packaging that if you tag a release, it will automatically make builds for you and post them right here for people to download. So that's pretty cool as well. Packaging is probably not perfect yet, but this does, with our GitHub Actions, take you end to end with packaging, code quality checks, and by default, we're running 26 different targets right now to make sure that we work on LLVM, GCC, and Visual Studio for Windows, Mac OS, and Linux. And it's a lot of targets for sure for this simple project. It currently takes 22 minutes to run. So if you do make your own project from this template, you might want to pare down some of the CI tasks that you're running, but it's all here and it's all covered automatic. So check this out. I think it's way better organization than it ever was before. And well, as always, thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly.